have the sister there.
Good morning, sir. My question, although I'm not reading any passage of the scripture.
Although you are not what?
It's not applicable to any verse of scripture.
Go ahead.
So it's a practical question, right? What I wanted to ask, I won't really say it's a question, but I wanted to raise it because it has been bothering my mind, especially the time I knew that it was the marriage and the family is the topic we are going to study today. What actually happened is that in the marriage in this church, I've noticed something, especially when we are in courtship, in the aspect of knowing the man, and in the aspect of the house the man is living. I wanted to know, why is it that sisters are not allowed to go to the brother's house? In the sense that he's not going directly there, but with a leader, either two leaders or one of the woman rep, so that the sister can know the situation in the house of the man. It's not that we'll just be talking together just like that without knowing the facts about the brother. We can always sit down together, we can always talk, but if you don't know where about the brother, and the brother just told the marriage committee that this is where I'm living, this is my lifestyle, and by the time you get to the house, you discover that the reverse is the case. And most of our sisters are harboring this thing in their mind. Some people, they are not enjoying their marriage in the sense that what they see when they get to the man's house is another thing. But I feel that at least they should give the sister the chance. It's not that I understand that they are trying to protect we sisters so that sin will not come in during our courtship. But at the same time, there should be some kind of allowance so that these sisters know. It's the thing that is bothering me. And I have to say, although I'm married, but for the people coming behind me, they have not made the same mistake. We are praying that we should get to heaven. But it's not that we should be praying and be binding the devil when we've gotten married. We always pray to get to heaven and to make other progress. Sir, my second question is on the aspect of our brothers. Although everybody has his weak points, but our brothers, I don't know, I wouldn't say maybe some of them, they don't make their kind of characters known to us even before the marriage. But when you get into the marriage, you begin to discover a lot of things. But I feel that maybe this singles and the singles program for men separate, for women separate, so that the brothers, they can know how to treat their wives. They can know how to go about marriage. These other churches, they have room for all those things. They teach them what they have to do. Even I have friends that when they share with me what they teach them, I feel bad that, God, as to me, we have this opportunity. I think we'll have worked better than this.
Thank you very much. Now, why do we have courtship? Our sister already said that as we eventually get married and we know these men and we know these women, we're surprised at what we see. And our sister is asking, why don't they allow us? We don't want to commit sin. We know that fornication is sinful. We know that immorality is sinful. We're not going to do that. Let somebody go with us. We're not going to go alone. Let's visit the man. Let's see how he lives. Let's see how neat his surrounding is. Let's see how his people are. You're not just marrying the man. You're marrying the man, but he has a lot of these people with him. His own mother, his own father, his own relatives and all the people. And when you get to their houses, you'll be able to see how they relate to you, respond to you, react to you. You'll see what's their own concepts about interpersonal relationship, about attitudinal manifestation. You'll see how his environment is. And our sister is saying, why is it that, you know, they get us somewhere when we're in courtship, and this is no man's land. Doesn't belong to the man, doesn't belong to the woman. And in this no man's land, and the man, if he's a good, well-controlled man, can be stingy with information, while the woman is generous with information. And then the man might just smile and say, you know, everything is all right. And you ask any question, everything is okay. You can never get anything positive or negative. Everything is okay. Everything is neutral. And this man is playing a game. Why don't we follow him to the house? Where does he live? Is he neat? Is he compatible? How does he reason? How lazy is it? Hard working is he? Which kind of people surround him? Show me your friends, and I'll show you who you are. Show me the kind of people you live with, and I'll show you. Show me your environment, and I'll show you the kind of person you are. That's what Azusa is saying. And I'm asking myself, why not? If not, follow them home. I'm assuming that, you know, any sister that's want to get married, I'm assuming that you are reasonable. You're not going to go at 12 o'clock in the night. You're not going to go at 11 o'clock in the night. You're going to go at a time you can see what you want to see. And I'm assuming that they meant you. I'm assuming that we're reasonable. And you're not going to go alone. And you're not going to ask foolish questions. You're not going to get into things that will get you into trouble. All you're looking for is, I'm taking this decision. And I can only marry once, except the woman or the man dies. And since this is just the decision I'm going to take, and my life is going to suffer for it, marriage committee is not going to bear my burden with me. Pastor GS is not going to bear my burden with me. And because this is my life, this thing may eventually land you in hell. You know, if you have such a traumatic marriage, you know, before you're married, you are coming to church, no concern, no care. You carried your Bible, you are happy, you are, you know, I'm deep alive. Now you get married, and there's fire at home. And then they invite you to come for deliverance there and come for prayer there. You never went to another place when you were single. What were you looking for? I just love my church deep alive. It's after the marriage. And after maybe there's no child, or the man is not working, and there's no money, and you're bearing the whole burden, and the man never says a thank you, and you're almost asleep there, and then you get dissatisfied with him, you get disenchanted with the church. It's after that you start looking about, and that may take heaven away from you. And if something will take heaven away from you, what are you going to look at? You know, pastor will not like that. Forget about me. What will I not like? Whatever you know will be for your future. Whatever you know will lead you to heaven. Whatever you know, this is my life and this is heaven for me. Go ahead. We'll taught you the principles. You can live by those principles. And when you've done that, and you know, if you need our help, we'll counsel you. If you must allow somebody to, you know, to be with you so you don't get into sin or into trouble. And our marriage committees, and actually our state overseers and regional overseers are here. Are you here, my brothers? Or you, can you stand up? Praise the Lord. I said, praise the Lord. They had a meeting that finished yesterday, and I knew what we'll be into today, so I sent a message to them. I said, please, don't go. Stay. Because I wanted you to hear my bombshell. So, praise the Lord. I knew that questions will come because I knew what we were studying today. I said, now that you are here, if you have been overhearing that, you know, the pastor has been saying this, and you are wondering, did he say that? I wanted you to hear from the horse's mouth. Praise the Lord. I said, praise the Lord. Our overseers, do you understand what I'm trying to say? The reason I'm telling the church this, your leaders, I'll tell you this. We do a lot of evangelism in this country. I don't think there's any other church that does as much evangelism, and we spend life, we spend the resources, we spend everything. And then we win a lot of souls into the kingdom, and they come into this church. And when it gets to marriage, you and I know that things have been so tough for our young people getting married that we lose hundreds or thousands of people from the church. And as I've been moving about, I go to this church. Somebody runs to me and greets me, and I say, how do you know me? He said, you are my pastor. I said, which church do you go? He mentions the church. I said, how am I your pastor if you know you're in another church? And the fellow will say, pastor, I love the teaching, I accept everything you say, but when I wanted to get married, pastor, I couldn't see you. It was tough. That's why I ran away. And now I'm married and, you know, and I'm okay where I am. And anytime you come for programming or see anywhere, I'll be there because you're still my pastor. Then I sat back and I said, how can we keep on doing this? That we're walking and we're losing the people. Because, not because of the law of God, not because of the doctrines of the Bible, but because of the laws that were set. And I said, if we really want people to get to heaven, and we know that God has raised deeper life up to be able to teach the way of truth, why don't we just relax any of these other things and not feel threatened in leadership and not feel that, okay, if they don't obey me, how can I be a real leader? I'd rather people don't obey me and they walk on me into the kingdom of God than stand in the way there and said, if you don't recognize me, you're not going to get to heaven. I don't want anybody to miss heaven because of me or because I'm trying to be a leader, a strong leader. I just teach the Bible and the rest I can forget. Is that all right, leaders? I said, is that all right? Give me a good yes. You don't have a microphone? Thank you. You can sit down. And so, church, that's the reason we're doing what we're doing. When you got saved, that was your personal decision. You got sanctified, that was your personal decision. And you became workers in the church, that's your personal decision. You're remaining in deeper life, that's your personal decision. And if those great decisions were yours, personal, the rest of your life, all the other decisions too should be your personal decision. I say should be your personal decision. I want to apologize on behalf of the church and leadership. Those of you who have gotten married and those of you who are still to get married. You know, sometimes we are majored in the minor. It might be a little thing, a little button in your dress and a little kind of lining in your scarf or whatever. I said, no, if you cannot shape up on this, I'm going to give you scripture for that. And just said, no, here we are. We're keeping the standard. Honestly contending for the faith which was once delivered unto the saints, contending for a button, contending for a lining in the scarf, contending for how long, you know, your wedding gown is, contending for, some even people say it must not be white, it must be red, is it? Black? Okay, you know the color now. Praise the Lord. I'm just saying that contending for the faith is not contending for the color of your dress. It's not contending for all these minor inconsequential things. It's contending for the truth, for the basic scripture. And that's why we're here. That's what we're standing on now. And the Lord will help us in Jesus' name. And those of us who have gotten married and you're having some challenges, I'm here for you. And by the grace of God, we'll turn everything around. And those of you who are still to get married, now you can relax and rejoice, because now I say, just look at the scriptures and follow the scriptures. Praise the Lord. I said, praise the Lord. I'll be firm where the scripture is clear. I'll be neutral while the scripture has nothing to say. Is that all right? That's right, sir.